Because the cross put the enemy to shame. And now my song echoes through an empty grave. Because the cross put the enemy to shame. And now my song echoes through an empty grave. Because the cross burned the enemy to shame.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. How's everybody doing today? Good to see you in the Lord's house. Is anybody ready to worship our Lord and our Savior in this place? Come on, stand if you would, please. A special welcome to our online audience today. We are so glad that you have joined us today. So whether you're in the house or you're watching online, we believe that the Spirit of the Lord has come to speak to you today in your situation. Anybody ready to hear what the Lord would say today in this place? Amen. If you're online, just send us a note. Say, hey, I'm here worshiping with you. So we're just excited about today. This is going to be an awesome day in His presence. Can we just go ahead and lift our hands and lift our voices right now? Just welcome the Spirit of the Lord in this house, Lord. This is your day. This is the day that the Lord has made. And so we choose to rejoice and to be glad in it. Father, Spirit of God, would you come and receive the praises of your people? Would you come and settle in the midst, God? Would you arise in this place? We bring you glory. We bring you praise. We thank you in advance for what you're going to do in this house today. We give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Somebody go ahead and put your hands together and thank him in advance for what he's going to do in this place today. Hallelujah.
You are the one. Hallelujah. Are you alive in Christ today? Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. See man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along, yes you did, and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
Turn seas into highways.
About 3 weeks ago, hallelujah, one of my friends, we were on our way to our vacation, my family and I, and one of our friends posted that her husband was in the hospital. And so she posted it on Facebook, so I got on my phone and I texted her. I said, "What's going on with your husband?" And she said he has COVID and he was on a respirator, 100% dependent on the respirator. And immediately I felt a press in my spirit to go before God. Sometimes, have you ever felt a press in your spirit? And she was asking everyone to pray, the community of believers. And I said, "Lord, I don't know who else is praying, but I gotta press in." And I pressed in and I pressed in and I pressed in. And I did not get up until I felt the weight lifted. We went on our vacation, and while we was there, we were praying the whole weekend. Every day there was a good report. See, I didn't want to believe the report of the doctors or the enemy. I believe the report of the Lord. In 7 days, he was out of the hospital, back with his wife and his family, breathing on his own. He's the only one who can. Do you understand? If there's an exchange that needs to take place, put it in the Lord's hands. I didn't go to Facebook to see what was going on. I didn't go online to MD Live to say, "Oh, you need to do this." I went to the source, the healer, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's sing it. You turn mourning. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning. You turn mourning to dancing. Hallelujah. Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn grace. You turn grace into glory. Yeah. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. The only one. He is the God of miracles. Hallelujah. He is the God of miracles. Hallelujah. 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 Don't let unbelief set in, but trust in him. He's the only one that gives hope. Hallelujah. He's the only one that gives hope. When society, when governments are not giving hope, Jesus gives us hope. Hallelujah. We have hope in this life and in the life to come if you know him. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I'm tired of what I see, Lord, I believe. while I was.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. I just want to stop right here. We're just going to pause. We're just going to go ahead and move into prayer today, because I know my God is a God that answers prayer. How many of you believe this morning that He is a God of miracles? He's a God of miracles. I believe we prepared this atmosphere for the Spirit of the Lord to begin to move in your situation. How many of you need this morning a God to do a miraculous thing in your life? Maybe in your home. Maybe in your business. Maybe in your family. Maybe in your own heart. You need God to show up in a miraculous way. I believe that He is that kind of God this morning. And I want us to right now to unite our hearts right now and just call on the God of miracles, to call on His name. We gather to worship Him. We gather to praise Him. But there are benefits to being in His presence. There are benefits to being in relationship with Him. And as a believer, as a follower, I lay claim to the promises. Oh, am I by myself in this room this morning? I said, I lay claim to the promises of God, because I stand on His promises. I go forward in His promises. That's how I get up every day, with hope. I have the assurance that my God is a God of promises, and I can depend on Him because He is forever faithful. Does anybody know He's faithful? See, I'm trying to get somebody to have a testimony at 9 o'clock this morning on a Sunday morning. I know it's early, and I know maybe you ain't having one cup of coffee, but listen, our God deserves our praise. Our God deserves our recognition. Our God is faithful, and I'm going to be faithful as a worshiper. I'm going to be faithful as someone who serves Him and gives Him everything. And I just declare today that He is the God of the miraculous. And if you need him to come into your situation, I want you to lay aside every other thought process right now, every distraction. And I don't know if you lift your hands. If you don't, I don't know why you don't. But I want to ask you to lift your hands in a posture to receive of the Lord this morning. And I want you to just receive what God has for you today. Let me just tell you, you might not even know that you need what God knows you need in here this morning, but God is here today. Thank God that He is that kind of sovereign, omniscient, all-knowing God. He knows what I need when I don't even know what I need. So I lift my hands and say, God, give me what I need today, even if I don't know that I need it right now. I surrender my life. I surrender my mind, my heart right now. I ask you to come into me, come into my situation, come into my home, come into my business right now. I ask you, God, just to be my God, just to show up in my life and all around me. God, show up, and I receive now what you have for me. You that are watching online right now, you that are worshiping with us right now online, receive of the Lord. Find yourself in a posture to receive right now. And as the blessings of heaven begin to pour into you and your situation, just begin to thank Him right now. Thank Him right now. Thank Him that your breakthrough has come. Your breakthrough has come in Jesus' name. Father, we receive it. We receive it. We receive in the name of Jesus. We receive it. We receive it. We receive it. Come on, I'm listening for a roar of God's people just to raise the roof in this place as we declare thanksgiving for our God that supplies every need, for our God that is our breakthrough, for our God that is our deliverance, for our God that is everything we need right now. I'm listening. I'm listening for a corporate voice of praise to arise to the throne this morning as we thank Him. As we thank Him for blessing us for what we need. I hear a few. Is there anybody else this morning that would lift your voice and say, God, I thank you. God, I thank you. God, I thank you. God, I thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, we lift our voices. We lift our hands. We lift our praise. God of miracles, come. Encounter with your Spirit in this place. We declare who you are. This is who you are, Lord. You're the God of miracles. You're the God of miracles. Come on, praise Him. Praise Him for your breakthrough this morning. Come on, praise Him. Praise Him for your breakthrough. praise him for your breakthrough. Let your praise silence your worry, your fear, your sorrow, your pain, your hurt, your memories. Let your praise drown out all of those voices. And right now, lift up a sound. Lift up a sound. Lift up a sound. See, the Lord inhabits. Do you want to experience God in here this morning? The Lord habits, which that word means he comes and sits down. He comes and sits down right in the praises of your of his people. Can you imagine a beautiful throne that sits right here above us, the praises of his people right here. Right now, he is inhabiting our praise. Revealed in your presence, change us today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you're moving in every situation. You know, everything we face today, God, we lift up the Ivy family, Tina Ivy's mom, who was found unresponsive. We lift her up right now, God. We pray. We just declare life in Jesus' name. God, would you work in this situation? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I pray for every person battling a physical infirmity today. Healing in the name of Jesus. You are Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals. You are Jehovah Shalom, the God of our peace. Hallelujah. We just declare everything that you are today. Hallelujah. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. We rest in you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Spirit of God, we worship you. We worship you and we bless your name today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in this place. Our hearts are ready and prepared. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, can we give him praise because he is here today to speak into our hearts and our lives. Come on, one more time. Thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for your goodness. Oh, I believe this is going to be a powerful time. You will not be sorry that you have come to church today. Whether you're here in the house or watching online, thank you for joining us. Stay with us if you're online. I believe God's got a powerful word for us today. So glad that you're here. Can we greet one another? Welcome each other here to his presence this morning. Thank you. Just want to give you a few announcements today. First of all, again, I want to thank you for being patient with us as we're in this process of registration and reserving of seats for Sundays. We have to do that because we have more people that we can sit than we can sit in two services. So that's why we're doing that. Thank you for going through the process. Thank you for being willing to be patient with us. We do have exciting news about kids ministry. We had said last week that we were going to start a nursery and kids ministry up on September 6th, I believe. But because of demand and because we were able to get personnel in place, we're going to begin to offer those next week, beginning next Sunday. Nursery, ages 0 to 23 months, we will offer childcare there. And preschool, ages 2 to 5, will begin next Sunday as well. Thank God for Pastor Joy and her team and what they're getting in place. You will, however, need to reserve seats or reserve places, register your children, because there is a limited number of seats. However, you can do it all at the same time that you're reserving your seat. You just simply type that word seats, S-E-A-T-S, text that word to the number 94,000, and you'll get a response. And you just tap on the link, and that's how you reserve your seats. You can do it all there in one spot. I do want to remind you, because we've had some people, I had some people even last night say, well, services are full tomorrow. Is there any spots available? And I had just happened to have looked, and I knew that there were still seats available. So what you have to remember to do is you have to send that word, you have to text that word seats every week, because it's a different link attached to a different date, okay? So you got to do that every week. You got to text the word seats. You can do it Sunday after church. You can do it. John, what time does it usually get up? About 1 o'clock. That link should be available. 1 o'clock after second service, you can do that, or you can certainly do it on Mondays. But again, you have to do it every week to make sure that you're reserving spots for the correct Sunday. So again, thank you for doing that. Again, we want to thank those that are watching online. We know that our online audience has grown tremendously through this whole COVID situation. If you are with us, and even the regular Heritage Church folks, if you're there, you know, there are a lot of times that I know you can view the service, but if you don't somehow interact by saying, hey, hi, I'm here, or, you know, if we don't see any comments, we don't know whether or not you are in service with us. So we're trying to maintain contact. I want to know who's still worshiping with us. So if you're online today, whether on our website or on Facebook, just say hi, say I'm here, say something so that we know that you are in service with us today. We want to thank you for doing that. And also, if you're on Facebook, click the share button. Again, we believe that God moves in this place, and we believe that God uses the ministry of this house to bless others. So share that if you're on Facebook. And we've just given us opportunity to minister to the people that God would privilege us to minister to. So again, thank you for all of that. It's so good to be in the Lord's house. We are going to receive our morning tithe and offering now. We're gonna do something different today. We got some space in between the rows. So even though we're not going to pass the bucket today, we're going to allow our ushers just to walk in between you, and you can drop your offering, your check, or your envelope in there. Ushers, if you'll come forward here, let's be old school this morning. And also, of course, you can give online if you like. You can text a dollar amount to that phone number. You can put a keyword in there if you like. As always, I thank you for being faithful. I thank you for being a people that gives, and you give out of obedience, and you give with cheerful hearts. I'm thankful for that. Let's pray over the offering and that which is received today. Lord, we honor you today with the return of the tithe and the gift of offerings. I just pray that you would bless the gifts, bless the givers, Lord. God, take what is used today, take what is received today. Use it to build your kingdom. Use it to bless this community. God, thank you for what Heritage Church is and what it does. God, and thank you for the opportunity to show you to those that are around us here. We thank you for that all. In Jesus' name, amen.
I did just receive word that Tina Ivey's mom did pass away this morning. So let's remember the Ivey family and trying to think of the actual family name. It has slipped my mind. But I just remember Tina, her daughter JC. She has a brother and a sister. And let's remember them. They just lost their father. It could not have been more than 6 weeks ago, maybe. Has not been any time at all. So let's pray for them, that God would be with them and be their comfort and peace. You can prepare to turn to Matthew 24 here in just a minute. But I, before I begin reading today, I just want to tell you, I have really been in prayer. I've really been seeking the Lord about this time that we're living in. How many of you know that there's never been a day like today? Well, certainly not in our lifetime. And I've really been seeking the Lord about, God, what are you wanting to say to the church? What are you wanting to say to us? You know, a lot of questions going on. What's happening now? Where are we in the biblical calendar? A lot of questions. Am I by myself, or is anybody else wondering what in the world is going on? There's a couple of things that I want to bring to you today, but the first is that I want to tell you that I feel impressed of the Lord to call a fast for our church. We are not the only ones doing this. There are a lot of well-known names on TV of churches that are doing fasts, different various kinds of fasts. But I feel led that we go into a time of fasting and seeking the Lord. And I want to tell you a little bit what I feel like God has put in me today. This is what we're going to do, and I'm calling it Fasting Fridays. Fasting Fridays. Beginning this coming Friday, August 28th, and it's going to run for 2 weeks through October 30th. October 30th is the last Friday before the election. And I am asking all that will to join me in a 12-hour fast on each Friday. No food from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And then, this is what we're going to do. I'm ringing a little bit, guys, if y'all could pull me back a touch. Then what we're going to do is after fasting all day on Friday, we're going to have prayer here at the church from 6 to 7 p.m. And I know you might be thinking, Friday night prayer? Yeah, this isn't for everybody. This is just for those who think prayer is important. So I just want to ask you to join me in that. The next 10 Fridays, 10 weeks, that's almost the summertime. 10 weeks, I'm asking you to join me for Friday fasts. I'm just saying this to reiterate. No food from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., and then prayer here from 6 to 7 p.m. And then you'll be ready to go out and to eat. You'll be ready to, you'll be ready to go out and eat then, I can tell you. But I want us to do this because we need to hear from God. We need to hear from God. And those that really want to hear from God, I believe, will participate. Just imagine, I know you're thinking again, Friday nights, really? Wow, Friday night. But imagine if through this time of prayer, Jesus said there's some things that only come through what? Prayer and fasting. What if that thing you've been praying for 10 years? Would it have been worth 10 days? Of sacrifice. I believe it will. So I'm asking you to join me for that. Why are we doing this? Why are we coming together? Why are we sacrificing through prayer and fasting? There's several things, and I have three things written down that this is what we're going to be praying for. The first is that We're going to be praying that we can hear the voice of God, that we will hear, as the body of Christ, we will hear what God wants to say in this season, that we would receive and carry His message to those around us. God is speaking right now. God is talking right now. What is He saying? Do you understand? Do you realize that there's always a specific message that is preached or that comes forth before every significant event in history? According to biblical history, this is just extra this morning. According to biblical history, the earth is only about 6,000 years old. And Genesis 1 through chapter 10 covers about 2,000 years. Genesis chapter 11 through the rest of the Old Testament covers about 2,000 years. And then, of course, it's been about 2,000 years since the New Testament began, and we're living here now in 2020. But here's the message that came, the messages that have come forth at every one of those significant events. In Genesis 6, we can read about Noah. God raised up Noah. And though we do not have words that he said or messages that he preached, the 1 Peter actually tells us, 1 Peter 2 says that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. I'm talking country here this morning, Noah. Noah was a preacher of righteousness. So 2,000 years after creation, there was a great flood where God destroyed all the people of the earth except Noah and his family. How many of you know that was a significant event in human history? Then 2,000 years later, God raises up a man named John the Baptist. What was his message? Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. And then Jesus Christ, the Son of God, appears on the scene. How many of you know when Jesus came and died on the cross and rose again from the grave, that was a significant event in history? So now it's been 2 years, 2,000 years again. And everybody's thinking, everybody's believing this. Again, every 2,000 years, something significant happens in the history of mankind. It's time, y'all. It's time for something. Here's what's happening. Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. So I believe that there's a message that God wants to be preached right now. There's a message that we are to share. And I'm not talking about just from a pulpit. I'm talking about coming from the mouths of those that are His. What's the message? What does He want us to say? That's what we're going to be seeking after in this time of prayer and fasting. The last days. You know, a lot of people are asking about the last days. Is it the last days? Are we living in the last days? Well, I actually went out to dinner with someone this past Friday, and they said, "Are we living in the last days?" And I said, "Yes, we are living in the last days." Actually, the last days begin in Acts chapter 2, when Peter stands up after the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit had been poured out, and they thought everybody was drunk, but that wasn't the case. Peter explained the situation. He said, "This is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel. In the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh." The last days begin in Acts chapter 2. And matter of fact, everybody since Acts chapter 2, or at least those believers, those that believe in the Christ, we've all been expecting Christ to return in our lifetime. I think we have, you know, and again, if Peter thought that, if Paul thought that, if the disciples thought that Jesus was going to come back during their lifetime, it's been 2,000 years since. How much more should we think that he is going to come back in our lifetime? I think it is going to happen in our lifetime. I think the Antichrist is already alive on the earth. Just hasn't been revealed yet. And so, what is God saying right now? That's what we want to go after. That's what we want to seek, because I want to have a message to preach as we prepare the way of the Lord to return. Luke 21, Jesus said, "Watch therefore." In other words, He said, "Be alert at all times. Pray continually that you might be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Are you listening? Are you paying attention? Are you ready? Because Jesus is coming back. He could come back today before this service is done. The second thing that I really want us to seek after in this time of fasting and prayer is concerning the upcoming election. That the will of God will be accomplished. That the right persons will occupy the White House for the next 4 years. And I can't imagine that there's ever been a more important election. And I want to challenge you to do that, to do this morning. And I want to challenge you to listen, to study, to search out what the candidates themselves say they're going to do. I want you to do that. Search it out for yourself. Don't take somebody else's word for it. You can find it. Go search it out for yourself. Listen to what they say they're going to do. Listen to what they say, the kind of policies that they are going to implement. And you vote accordingly. I pray that you will vote according to the word of the Lord. So we're going to pray for that, that the will of God will be accomplished in this coming election. And just pray that God's hand is in it. Again, that last Friday, it will take us right up to the Friday before the election. So that's another thing. The third thing is that truth and light would overcome the lies of the darkness. Truth and light would overcome the lies of the darkness. Because in these days, there is a force at work among us that's bigger than prejudice. It's bigger than racism. It's bigger than murder. It's bigger than idolatry. It's bigger than fornication. This thing I'm talking about, if you put all of those things together and then add on top every other wicked thing, you get this thing that I'm going to talk about this morning, and that is this: deception. Deception. I really feel like I'm on assignment this morning. And already I feel His presence here. And I really feel like that God has put this word in my spirit. And we will not finish this today. But deception is rampant in our world right now. You know, I've never been one to be satisfied to take up your time on a Sunday morning. But I really seek the Lord to find a word. And the word, this is the word that He has put in my spirit for today: deception. And when I say that word, you probably think of a lot of things other than yourself. But I think the word of the Lord today is that not only do we look around us, but that we look within us. Because again, deception is rampant. And I want to read today from Matthew 24, if you'll turn there with me. You can follow along in your Bible or you can follow on the screen. This is what Jesus said, 24, verse 1. It says, I'm sorry, verse 3 is where we're going to begin. Matthew 24, verse 3. Now, as He sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to Him privately, saying, "Tell us, when will these things be, and when will be this, and what will be the sign of Your coming and of the end of the age?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in My name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be famines, pestilences, earthquakes in various places." Y'all hear about any of those? "All of these are the beginnings of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you. And you will be hated by all nations for My name's sake." You know, initially He was talking to the disciples. How many of you know every one of the disciples were martyred for the cause of the gospel? Verse 10, "And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many.
and because lawlessness will abound.
Oh, my goodness. Everywhere we look, lawlessness.
Because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Listen to this phrase. But he who endures to the end shall be saved.
I don't care what message I could come with today. Thank God the true gospel of Jesus Christ always can be ended with a message of hope, that we have the hope of because of Jesus. If we can endure, no matter what else we have to face, no matter what else we have to go through, if we can endure, if we will endure, we shall be saved.
And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. I want to ask you to do something today. We passed out those cards. You can take notes on them if you like. I just want to ask you, especially if there are any young people in the room, I want to ask you to put your phones up because I want you to listen to me just for a few minutes now. I want you to listen to me because what I'm about to tell you is very important. Do you understand this morning that the only way the devil can influence you is to get you to believe a lie? The only way that the devil can influence you today is to get you to believe a lie. Jesus said of the devil in John 8:44, he said he can't tell the truth because there's no truth in him. You can't tell the truth. You ever met somebody that seemed like they were that way? It can't tell the truth because, you know, you can't tell the truth unless there's some truth in you. Or if you don't have any in you, no truth's going to come out of you. That's what Jesus says the devil was like. He can't tell the truth because there's no truth in him. He said when he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature. When he speaks from what he is a lie. That's what Jesus was saying. He is a lie. Because he is a lie, because he is a liar, and a father, the father of all lies. Matter of fact, when a person lies, they praise the devil. Because when you lie, you're proclaiming what he is, and you're promoting what he does. Think about that, the next little white lie you tell. But the best the devil can do is to distort the truth, to twist it, just enough for it to become plausible. So that with your fallen mind and with faulty reasoning, you will accept the lie as the truth. And the only way that we can prevent falling from the lies of the devil is, number one, we have to walk in the Spirit of God. We have to be led by the Spirit of God. We have to be in constant communion and fellowship with the Spirit of God. You've got to walk in the Spirit of God. I hope you understand that the Spirit of God is not something you turn on and off in your life. I hope you don't turn on your relationship with God on Sundays when it's time to come to church and then you flip off the switch when you walk out the doors. I hope that you understand that the real life of Christ is that you walk and you breathe. You breathe in His presence. You breathe in Him. You walk with Him every day. You discern by Him. You are led by Him. He is with you. He is guiding you. He protects you. He checks you. He warns you. He gives you instruction. The only way, the first way that you detect the lie of the enemy is that you have to walk in the Spirit of God. The second way, the only other way, is that you've got to know the truth of God's Word. You have to know what the Bible says. Some people say, well, I've been a Christian for 40 years. Well, yeah, that don't mean a thing if you haven't learned something in 40 years. Are you learning Scripture? Are you learning truth? Experience and longevity doesn't mean anything. As a believer, I must pursue the knowledge of God. I must have a heart attitude that says, I want to know more about God. So I make it a habit to daily commune with God. I go and read my Bible. I go and pray. I know how easy it is. That just does not happen on its own. You have to be deliberate about it. You have to pursue God on your own. Nobody can make you do it. Nobody can do it for you. You can only come to know God by your own efforts. And thank God for the fact that He desires, again, to be known. He desires to be known. So that I just pray that you understand that.
The reality is that that's why so many people are struggling right now in this coronavirus situation. For a period of time, we had to shut down corporate church, and it has showed up in the lives of those who that was the only God that they got. Because now they're weak. Now they're struggling. Now they're trying to get their faith back. Now they're trying to get their praise back. I'm just going to be real in here this morning. I'm just telling you what I've observed. Can you survive as a believer if they started blowing up churches like they're doing in China? Can you survive as a believer? What will your faith look like in 6 months? What will your faith look like in a year? What will your family look like? Will it still be Christ-centered? I think it's a question. It's a valid question and something we need to think through. You have to know God outside of these four walls. You've got to know God outside of what you hear spoken or experienced in this room or online. You have to have your own relationship with God. The beauty of Christianity, the beauty of fellowship, the beauty of the life of the believer is that I don't have to have you to experience Him. I experience Him all day long, everywhere that I go. People ask me, when do you pray? I pray all the time. I pray all the time. If you pass me in the car and it looks like I'm talking to myself, I'm not talking to myself, I'm talking to Jesus. If you see me playing drums on my steering wheel at the stoplight, I ain't crazy, I ain't mad, I'm worshiping. I'm just telling you, that's how it needs to be for us. Somebody help me. We have to incorporate a life of with God and fellowship. We have to maintain and pursue truth. We have to pursue truth. That's what I'm trying to get to. That's what I'm trying to convey this morning. You have to have your own pursuit of truth. If not, how many of you know any of us can be deceived? The devil is trying to deceive each of us by getting us to believe a lie, any lie, and he knows exactly which lie you are more prone to believe. And by the way, if you think you are above being deceived, you're already deceived. Eve was deceived, Cain was deceived, Lot was deceived, Moses was deceived, Elijah was deceived, David was deceived. Judas was deceived. Peter was deceived. What makes you think that you're above deception? We need to analyze and study the truth that comes our way. All the information that comes our way, we need to analyze it and study. Because in today's world, listen, I believe this, that in today's world, we experience more lies than truth on a daily basis. How do you know which is which? Your survival as a believer depends on it. How do you know which is truth and which is the lie? The disciples asked. They asked the same question that we're asking today. Jesus, how will we know? What will the signs be that the end of the age has come? And you know what he did? He didn't start talking about signs. He started talking about them. He started talking about their hearts. And the first thing out of his mouth was this. He said, be aware, take heed that no one deceives you. Take heed that no one deceives you, that you're not misled. Hebrews 13:3, the Apostle Paul says the same thing. He says, do not be carried away about, or do not be carried about with various or strange doctrines. Because in verse 1, the previous verse, he said, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. 1 Timothy 4:1 says this, in the latter days, some will turn away from the true faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. These people are hypocrites and liars, and their consciences are dead. Deception. Let me just tell you about deception quickly. What is it? Deception, what is it? First of all, it's this. It's spirit-driven. It's spirit-driven. If we can throw that slide up there, I got a little, kind of some definition for you. Deception, it's spirit-driven. It's demonic spirits seeking to influence, to control your thoughts and your behavior, ultimately shaping your character. That's what deception is. It is spirit-driven. You think some people, they're just, you know, people are mean. People are bad. Can I just tell you that? Behind every act of anger is a spirit promoting the act. Deception. And again, part of today, I just want to inform you. Because I know there are probably some people in here that think, you know, all you super spiritualists, that, you know, you think everything's a devil, you think everything's a demon. I'll just tell you, I am not like that. I don't see a devil hiding behind every bush. I'm not like that. But I want to bring you what the Bible, the spirits, you can find them in Scripture. And by the way, if you want what I'm getting ready to give you, I can give it to you, give you all this information. But the Bible calls these spirits by name. I want to tell you what they are. Because the devil has many weapons of deception. Many weapons of deception. These are real. And again, their objective is to influence you, to gain control over you. Here's the first. Spirit of divination. Spirit of divination. Divination is the practice of seeking knowledge of the future or the unknown by the aid of supernatural powers. Spirits of divination speak through various practices and communicate with those who indulge in such things as witchcraft, fortune telling, horoscopes, drug use. I just read this week of a group of people in Centennial, Colorado. They call themselves the Stoner Jesus Bible Study. They sit around, smoke marijuana, and study the Bible. One participant said, "We get really deep, deeper than I've ever gotten before." And I'm thinking, I bet so. There's nothing like having a spirit of divination explain Scripture to you. I wonder what kind of conclusions they come up with about Scripture. Deception, y'all. Here's another. The Bible speaks of what is called a familiar spirit. This is that, we see this found in Scripture when there were mediums. Those who claimed the ability to communicate with the spirits of dead people. In actuality, what's happening, they're not conversing with the dead. They speak with demonic spirits who are posing as the dead person. A familiar spirit. And when we open ourselves up to that, I say we. I ain't never done it. I hope you ain't either. But when someone opens themselves up to that, imagine the influence. I mean, you're asking, you're seeking influence of the demonic realm. Familiar spirits. Here's a third. The spirit of jealousy. The spirit of jealousy. Again, we're talking about the methods, the weapons that Satan, the devil, has in his arsenal to try to deceive you. The spirit of jealousy. It manifests in the actions of murder, revenge, spite, anger, rage, hate, contention. How about this one? Competition. Manifests in the form of envy, division, and of course, jealousy. The spirit of jealousy. Here's one, and of course, this makes sense. One that the Bible refers to as a lying spirit. A lying spirit. It manifests in the form of flattery, false prophecy, false teaching, false accusations, slander, gossip, and of course, lies. See, I think we need to think about our own actions and our own habits. Those things that we've forgotten that we do, and all of a sudden our own words, our own actions surprise us one day. And we need to make sure that we have not fallen culprit to these spirits of deception. The next is this, a perverse spirit. Perverse spirit. Perverse, referring to that which is perverted. That which warps, distorts, perverts. In other words, taking something that was right, but now twisting it. A perverting spirit. It manifests in atheism, abortion, child abuse, heresy, the teaching of false doctrines, sex perversions, homosexuality, fornication, adultery, bestiality, incest, pornography, a perverse spirit. Here's another, the spirit of haughtiness. Manifests or seen in this way. It's seen in arrogance, pride, idleness, obstinance, self-righteousness, rebellion, rejection of God. And I know this is a whole lot of stuff. And again, if you want all of this, I've got it in paper form. I can give it to you. I can give you one sheet and it's got all of it on it. Because these are things that we need to be aware of. A couple more. Spirit of heaviness. The spirit of heaviness. Manifests as excessive mourning, sorrow, or grief. Excessive sorrow, excessive grief. There's a time for those and a place for those things. But how many of you know some people can become consumed and it can become their identity? And it, in that case, they're functioning under the influence of the spirit of heaviness. Also manifests in this form, insomnia, self-pity, rejection, despair, dejection, hopelessness, depression, and suicidal thoughts. Here's the next. Spirit of whoredoms. Manifest as infidelity, unfaithfulness, adultery, prostitution, idolatry, worldliness. I don't have time to go. There's some others. Let me just quickly mention a few more. The spirit of bondage, the spirit of fear, the spirit of Antichrist, seducing spirits, and then the spirit of death. You say, what are you doing this morning? I'm simply trying to make you aware of the weapons that Satan has in his arsenal. I know that in the end of it all, Satan is a defeated foe, but right now I can tell you that your key is knowledge. Your key is information. Your key is understanding. And if you're not aware of his tactics, he can and will influence your thoughts. He'll influence your decisions. He'll influence your actions. He'll influence your destiny. And ultimately, he will influence your eternity. How many of you know I do not want Satan, the fallen angel from heaven, to determine where I spend eternity? So if I don't want that to happen, I have to understand his tactics right now, especially in this day. I need to be preparing my heart and my soul and my mind and my spirit for what's coming. Because again, I believe something significant is about to happen in the timeline of history. And I believe that this is a very pertinent word for today, because deception is everywhere. Deception is rampant all around us. Forget culture. Let's talk about within the church. We've accepted too many doctrines that say truth is relative, that the application of truth is dependent on my situation, that truth is situational. And we placed a higher value on convenience than truth. How can that? I know that that's what it says, but this is my reality. How many of you know your reality never trumps what it says? Your experience never trumps what it says. I pray that you had an experience in God, but there's a lot of other spirits out there that might have caused you to think something, to feel something, to do something, to enjoy something. We have to be aware. Truth that's trumped by feelings. I know this is what the Bible says, but this is what I feel. How can I be held accountable if I feel this way? Let me just tell you, if we just say, if you feel it, you okay to do it? Can I tell you what can I tell you what we would look like? If we just justified our feelings and said, I'm going to do what I feel because I feel like God created me this way. You know, hey, let's just, you know, we've got this push now that's pushing this agenda to turn pedophilia into a sexual orientation. We're going to do it with animals next. We're just going to say, okay, I'm married Bette Nelly over here, my cow. You know, we have an awesome intimate relationship. We're deceived by our desires. I know your word says that, God, but this is me. Could it be possible that you're deceived? Deceived by desires. We are deceived by culture. Even church culture. Can I just tell you that even if everybody else is doing it in the church, it doesn't mean that it's all right according to God's word. We're deceived by our own color. If he or she is my color, then that's whose side I'm on. We're deceived by political affiliation. I'm talking about on both sides of the aisle. We blindly follow according to the platforms without question. Can we just be honest and say, I'm not going to live by those things. I'm going to live according to the word of God. I'm going to live by, you know, and too many of us just say, you know what, it's better. At least this one's better than the other. Well, I'm asking, can we stand up and just declare truth again? That's why we must be led by the Spirit of God. We cannot trust our minds. I can't. We certainly cannot trust our bodies. We have to be led by the Spirit of God. Does anybody agree with me here in this place this morning? Today our prayer should be like the old hymn, "Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be any wicked way in me, cleanse me from every sin and set me free. If there's any place in my life that I am deceived, Lord, I beg you, show it to me, that I can confess it, that I can get it right. I don't want to live by habits. I don't want to live just by what I've seen. I don't want to live just by what I took for granted as being truth. I want to go on a pursuit. I want to go on a treasure hunt. In this book right here, there are the treasures of God laid up for you right here. You don't get it by coming to church. You don't get it just by sitting in a corporate worship service. God has treasures that he wants to give to you, and you will only receive your treasures when you spend time with him one-on-one and hear him speak into your life and into your mind and see the light bulbs go off and say, oh, wow, God, I see and I understand now. Without fail, every time you open up his book, it reads your life and speaks into your situation. It's like looking in the mirror. God knows exactly what you need, but we turn everywhere else for the answers of life. Right here is where we find what we need. I believe that it's time for us really to examine ourselves. I feel like God is calling us forward. I believe that God is calling us to rise up against the deception that's all around us by declaring the truth of God. I love the story in Ezekiel. The Lord came to Ezekiel and said, "Son of man, I made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Therefore, hear a word from my mouth and give them warning for me." The Lord is looking for watchmen and women who will stand up on the wall, who will rise up with a word from the mouth of God. But let me just tell you, there's no need to rise up if you haven't heard from God. And you can't be a watchman if you don't have a word. Oh, my God, help me. You can't be a watchman if you don't have a word. Somebody hear me. When is the last time that you got your own word from God? I believe that God is calling us to rise up and say, I'm going after you, God. I want to understand your truth. I want to go after you, and I want to receive the word of the Lord. I want to have a message. I want to be a watchman, but to be a watchman, I got to have a word. So, God, I go after you. I seek your word. What are you saying to me? I want to be a messenger. I want to speak for you. God, I'm listening. I'll be a watchman on the wall, because Jesus is coming back soon. Are you ready? Are you ready for his return? Heather, if you'll come, please. Listen to me a second. Satan's greatest deception, just like he did for Eve, is to convince you that the warnings of sin do not apply to you. He's always got a, yeah, it says this, but. That's his greatest deception. That I am the exception. That my situation, my feelings, my history, what I've been through, that it changes what God said. Now, what God said was established before the foundations of the earth. The Word of God was there. In the beginning was the Word. Before God created anything, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then that Word became flesh and dwelt among us. But the Word is the Word. Your situation doesn't change the Word. The Word is what it is. If the Bible says that it's sin for all of us. I just want to ask you to bow your heads for a minute. What is the Spirit of God saying to you right now? What are you feeling? What are you sensing in your spirit and in your heart? Maybe as I've been speaking, those of you here in the room and those of you that are watching online, maybe there's been something that the Spirit has been speaking to you right now. Maybe it's something that you've allowed to in your life, maybe allowed back into your life, or maybe it's an area of your life that you had yet to surrender, and now the conviction of the Spirit of the Lord is here and is manifesting. You feel it, you sense it, you know it. I don't want you to ignore it, because again, today, God is calling you up. God is trying to raise you up to a place with voice, a place where you have a message, a place where you can hear the word of the Lord and deliver it to those around you. I always hear, or I see this scenario play out in my mind when I think about eternity. When I think about the fact that every single one of us will stand before the Almighty God and give an account for our life. The one thing that I always see and it's become part of my drive. I see and I hear someone turn to me and say, why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you tell me that there was a hell? Why didn't you tell me? I pray that that rationalization would be received by us all, and that we would carry that and understand that you, as a believer, you have been put here on the earth to carry the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Wouldn't it be a shame if somebody that you knew
a neighbor, a family member, anybody, somebody you work with, wouldn't it be the worst day of your life for them to look at you one day as the judgment of God is being pronounced on their life, to hear them say to you, "Why didn't you tell me?" I know this is heavy this morning, but listen, we're living in a heavy day. We're living in a day where this message needs to be declared, because there are too many people around us right now headed at a high rate of speed towards the gates of hell. But don't ever underestimate the power of the gospel. And if you surrender your life and speak one word in obedience, their whole life, their whole identity, their whole existence can be changed in a moment. God is calling up watchmen who will take their place on the wall with a message from God and declare, "God loves you. You're created for purpose. Surrender your life to God. Let Him make you into something you never thought you could become. Let Him heal your hurts. Let Him deliver you from your bondages. Let Him set you free. Let Him give you eternal life." God wants to use you for a message, with a message such as that. If you will stay here in this place this morning, I'm ready to take my place as a watchman on the wall. I want to ask you to stand up in here. I'm ready to take my place and do my part for the kingdom of God. I want to ask you to stand up. Stand up. Stand up. I will be a watchman on the wall. I will be a watchman on the wall. And I pray over every person in this place right now. Lord, thank you for those that are willing to say, "Yes, yes, yes, yes. I'll be a watchman." But God, as we stand, we ask that, first of all, God, that you would cleanse us of anything. Like David prayed, we prayed that same prayer, "Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Renew a right spirit in me." Lord, this morning we pray that prayer. How many of you will pray that prayer with me? God, if there's any area of deception in me, would you let me see it? Would you let me see it right now? Lord, would you let me see it? We're going to sing this song. As we sing this song, it's been a long time since we prayed around these altars. And I know you can pray at your seat, but there's something about coming together, praying at the altar. If you're watching online, I'm going to ask you that now, as we sing, that you would make yourself, find yourself, set up for yourself an altar. And I want us to come and seek the Lord. Lord, see if there be any way in me. Search me, O God. Search me. Because I want every part of my life to honor and to glorify you. Search me, O God. Search me. Hallelujah. 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 How many of you will let Him search you this morning? Oh, thank you, Jesus. All to you I surrender. Everything, every part of me, all to you I surrender. All of my hopes, all of my dreams, yeah, all to you I surrender. Everything, every part of me, all to you.
I surrender all my dreams, all of me, yeah, I surrender. Oh, I surrender.
We're going to sing this verse as we do. I want to ask you all that will, come find yourself around this altar. Can we get on our knees? There's something about bowing before Him. There's something about kneeling before Him and asking Him to cleanse us and purge us. Would you do that? Would you do that? Come on, don't be afraid of the altar. The altar is just a place of surrender. The altar is just a place where we say, God, I'm yours. The altar is just a place where I give everything to God. Come on, as we sing.
There is no love sweeter than the love you pour on me. There is no song sweeter than the song you sing to me. There is no place that I would rather be than here at your feet, laying down everything. All to you I surrender.
Surrender everything to you, Lord. Let me see me for who I am. Lord, I become vulnerable in your presence, Lord. Whatever you would say to me, Lord, I receive it today. I receive it today. I receive it today. I've come to you. I lay everything down. I lay down my life before you. I lay myself before you and I ask you, search me, oh God. Know me, my Lord. Know me. Know me. Let me know myself. God, help me in those areas that I am found with fault, God, in those areas where there's still sin. Lord, we repent, we confess, and we repent. God, would you make me who I am in need to become? Would you set me up as a watchman on the wall, God? I just surrender everything to you today. I surrender everything to you today. I surrender everything to you today. I surrender. Oh, I surrender, yeah. Oh, all to you, I surrender everything, every part of me, all to you, I surrender. I surrender every
If worship's like perfume, I'll pour mine out on you. For there is none as deserving of my love like you. So take
sing it with me.
I surrender all and all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. One more time, say, yes, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender
all. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your presence. Enjoy his presence. We never rush his presence. Just listen. I believe he's speaking to you right now. Just listen. Just listen a minute. presence of the Lord. Lord, we are so grateful for your presence. Restoration in your presence. For peace found in your presence. For direction found in your presence. We thank you. We thank you. Healing oil of God. Feel in my spirit right now, the healing taking place all over this place. The healing oil. Lord, let your anointing flow. Let healing flow. Let healing flow. Healing in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, this week we're going to listen for your words. We're going to pursue your presence. We will come and sit at your feet. We will change our schedules because you are the most important thing.
We will change. We're going to do whatever we got to do to receive a word from you. We will be the watchman on the wall with a word of warning that you're coming soon. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Lord, don't let this be one of those words that we forget easily. But Lord, now it is written on our hearts, and daily we will pursue and take our place, our position. Thank you, Lord, for raising up watchmen and watchwomen. Thank you, Father, for it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. The Lord is good. The Lord is good. We're not going to interrupt these guys that are praying around the altar. You guys can pray as long as you like. I want to thank you again for being here with us today. Thank you for those that are worshiping with us online. I'm praying for you. I'm praying that we can make a difference in this world that we live in. I'm praying that God would protect us and sustain us, that God would use us. I know a lot of preachers preach a lot of different things, but I'm not so much interested in you having a good day. I'm interested in you having a good eternity. I know all of us who know him one day are going to be so grateful that somebody shared the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ with us. I'm already grateful. Amen. Let's carry the Spirit of the Lord wherever we go. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next week. We'll see you Friday night. All who will, join us Friday night. Join us with the fast, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Prayer here at 6 p.m. Thank you much. God bless you.